Hello. Really nice to be here virtually. And now that we have, I think, more than 1.5 meters of physical distance, I'll take this mask off and begin the sharing. Digital social innovation really is the key in the Taiwan model, countering not only the pandemic, which we succeeded with no lockdown, but also the infodemic, which we succeeded with no takedowns. And just today, just a couple hours ago, the Taiwan Exchange of Stock Market reached a historic high. And the past couple months, we've seen the catering and retail businesses also reporting historic highs. And so definitely the economic impact of the COVID has been minimized thanks to the social innovators. So how did Taiwan do it? And how can you, regardless of which jurisdiction you are in, learn a little bit about our playbook, which we formed in 2004, right after the SARS 1.0 epidemic in Taiwan? Well, there's three pillars in the Taiwan model of social innovation, and they're called fast, fair, and fun. The fast part concerns collective intelligence. We have broadband as a human right in Taiwan. Everybody have 10 megabits per second, regardless of how high a mountain they're in, or whether they're in a remote island or rural areas. If you don't have 10 megabits per second for just $16 per month, it's my fault, personally. That's coupled with the freedom of speech and a social sector maintained Reddit equivalent, the PTT, means that people are eager to report any advance warnings of SARS. And so last December, when Dr. Li Wenliang, the PRC whistleblower, reported there were, and I quote, seven new SARS cases in Wuhan, unquote, then I mentioned that we have this SARS experience, so it rings an alarm bell in everybody's head. And so we not only send an email to the World Health Organization asking for a clarification, but without getting a reply, started health inspections for flight passengers coming in from Wuhan because there's a lot of upvotes, a lot of people on PTT that triage the information from Dr. Li Wenliang, which saved all of the Taiwanese, and saw that it is as legit as it could be. And so, according to the Civicus Monitor, Taiwan is the only place in Asia that they rank as completely open in terms of freedom of speech, freedom of assembly, and freedom of the press, and so on. So that means that people can freely talk about SARS 2.0 without worrying that the state may harmonize their messages, and also that the state trusts the citizens enough so that these early warning signals are translated into actionable measures such as the Central Epidemic Command Center or the CECC. The CECC is a constitutionally mandated response. That is to say, it is a part of our constitutional law system without any emergency or crisis state declarations by the president, because it was designed in by the parliament in 2004, right after the initial SARS 1.0. And so this constitutionally approved response system unifies the communication from the central government, the municipal government, and all the different sectors. Every 2 p.m. during the height of the pandemic this time, everybody just watched the live stream or the podcast or whatever form, radio and so on, of the CECC press conferences where the Quint, the five medical officers, share the latest developments and answer all the questions from all the journalists. And that in turn empowers trust because anyone can call 1922, a hotline, and there's more than 95% chance of being immediately picked up and get all your worries or your questions answered. Of course, there are higher tech like chatbots and so on solutions as well, but a hotline toll-free number really calms everyone down. And also, instead of just getting their questions answered, they can suggest new things too. In April, there was a day when a young boy called the hotline saying, "Hey, you're rationing out medical masks, but all I get was pink medical masks. I don't want to wear them to school, for my classmates may laugh at me." Well, the very next day, all the medical offices, including Minister Chen Shizhong, wore pink medical mask. Minister Chen even said that Pink Panther was his childhood hero or something. And so the boy become not only the most hit boy in the class, for only he has the color that the heroes wear, but also heroes, but also all the trending bronze and so on, colored their social media profiles pink. So pink became the most fashionable color for a while. And so that in turn earns trustworthiness across all the sectors and ensure that people wear a mask to protect themselves from their own and washed hands. That is the most important measure early on. When we get 3/4 of people wearing masks and washing their hands properly, the R value, the basic transmission rate, dropped to below 1. So by April, like by this time that you saw this pink masking, the R value passed the threshold, passed the horizon, so that by May, we don't have local transmissions anymore. So early on, we only have the production facility to make not even 2 million masks per day. On the other hand, we have more than 23 million people. So some sort of rationing against stockpiling is needed. And so because we have a heuristic, a rule of thumb that says we must not collect new data in the name of pandemic that we were not already collecting before the pandemic. This is a privacy first norm that protects the cybersecurity and the privacy parameters of the society from the state collecting more data in the name of the pandemic. So we designed deliberately the mask rationing system to take place in pharmacies. The 6,000 pharmacists already trusted by their local community can explain in depth how this experience is like refilling their chronic prescriptions. And the many elderly people, all of them have the national IC card for single-payer healthcare, which covers more than 99.99% of not just citizens, but also residents. And so building on this familiarity comes the mask rationing proposal. And so around the same time, a young civic hacker named Howard Wu Jiangwei in Tainan City coded up this map that you're looking at right now. And working with the civic hackers, who are, you know, people who make new systems, not people who infiltrate and hack existing systems, which are cybersecurity hackers. So the civic hackers work for more than, I think, 140 tools on the latest count. And in each of those tools, it may be a map, maybe a chatbot, it may be a system analysis like a stock exchange that shows distribution disparities and so on. They make use of the real-time open data, or the open API, as we call it here, in the National Health Insurance Agency. The NHIA work with the pharmacies to publish the real-time mask availability in each and every pharmacy every 30 seconds. So people queuing in line can check with their phone on how many masks exactly did the person queuing before them actually purchase. And this, in turn, is like a distributed ledger to more than 100 different nodes, right? So this distributed ledger builds trustworthiness across the board. So when we ramp up the production from 2 million to 20 million masks a day, people can see that it's being evenly distributed in a fair fashion. And it also enables us to see why the accessibility of the medical mask kind of plateaued on 3/4. And the reason is that for people working very long hours and didn't live with their family, they couldn't go to the pharmacies because by the time they go off work, the pharmacy have already closed. And so to close this gap starting March, that is to say around a month after the initial mask rationing, we enlisted 12,000 convenience stores. And so the economic sector work with the social sector, civic hackers, as well as the public sector people, the GovTech people. Together, we quadrupled the distribution points of medical masks, and people can pre-order using an app or using a kiosk and pick it up a week or so later in the nearby convenience store, which opens 24 hours a day. So you can see our premier Su Zhenchang smiling quite happily because that was the day that we started the mask rationing in the convenience stores. And altogether, this reached more than 95% of the population of the medical mask with proper appropriate usage instructions. And well, what happened to those 5%? Many of them told me that they already have plenty of masks in stock in their home. And so they asked me to implement a new function, which we call the eMask 4.0, which says that they can dedicate the rationing that they did not collect for international humanitarian aid. And indeed, our foreign ministry did work on it, and we did implement that function. So to date, more than 7 million medical masks were dedicated by more than 700,000 people, citizens and residents, toward international humanitarian aid. And so that is the fair part. It's not just domestic, it's also international. And finally, while there is nothing fun about COVID, making sure that people can stay calm and collected during the pandemic instead of buying in to conspiracy theories is also very important. And we have a special term for that. It's called humor over boomer. For you see, joy has a higher R value than rage. And when people share something on the social media driven by rage, usually that's because they have a need to seek for, I don't know, discrimination or revenge or some other toxic, polarizing feelings. That gets trendy. However, joy is even more trendy. So, for example, also around April, there was a rumor, a popular rumor that said, and I quote, "We're ramping up the medical mask production, and all the tissue paper materials are being confiscated by the state to make masks, so we'll run out of tissue paper soon," unquote. And this, of course, travels on outrage, and people went out and panic buy. But not even 2 hours later, our premier, Su Zhenchang, you just saw his front side, now it's his backside, showed this meme, internet meme, that says in very clear, large letters, "Each of us only have one pair of bottoms." For this is a wordplay, a homonym in Mandarin, to stockpile twin sounds the same as bottom twin. And so it went viral. And people really share that. And by making himself quite literally the butt of the joke, everybody saw this table that shows very clearly that the tissue papers were made out of South American materials, while the medical masks are made out of domestic materials. There's no way that one could be confiscated to make the other. And so over a weekend, the panic buying stopped and people remains calm and collected. And this is not just a one-shot response. Actually, right after each Central Epidemic Command Center press conference, if there's new measure being introduced, for example, the physical distancing that you see on the top left corner here, well, the spokesdoc of the CECC, a Shiba Inu that lives with the participation officer of the Ministry of Health and Welfare, an actual dog. So the participation officer would just walk home, take a new photo of the dog, and then post viral dog memes that explains when you're indoors, we have to keep 3 Shiba Inus away from one another or wear a mask. Outdoors, keep 2 Shiba Inus away or wear a mask. Remember to cover your mouth and nose when sneezing. Don't do what the dog is doing. And remember to buy your medical mask. But what do you do with those medical masks? Well, it's there to prevent you from accidentally 下到吃手手, put your hand in your mouth, quite literally. So this is here to protect you from your own unwashed hands. And you should wash them with soap. And this is a message out of rational self-interest. That is to say, this appeals to all age groups and people of all political inclinations. They will all share this cute dog picture quite virally. For had we said, for example, wear a mask to respect the elderly, then people who don't live with the elderly may not share this message. If we say wear a mask to protect each other, then people who don't want to protect each other will not share this message. But wear a mask to protect oneself from one's own unwashed hands. Well, that is something that everybody can agree on, and it gets more trending and more viral than any of the conspiracy theories. So that is my sharing today, and you can find more about the Taiwan model, including the digital quarantine and all that, at taiwancanhelp.us. Thank you for listening. Live long and prosper.
Well, thank you very much, Minister Tan, for your valuable insight. Once again, what honor it was for us to welcome you. Fantastic. Thank you.